We have two cars here. One of the cars is parked on the road, that is, it is at rest, whereas the other car is speeding with a great velocity. What happens when the speeding car hits the car at rest? We see that because of the collision, the speeding car slows down and the car at rest is set in motion. From Newton's first law of motion, we know that an object at rest continues to be at rest and an object in motion continues to move with the same velocity unless an unbalanced force is applied to it. Now, in our previous case, we had two cars. So according to Newton's first law, the parked car would have continued to be at rest if an unbalanced force did not act upon it. So what was the unbalanced force that acted on the parked car so that it moved? It was the force exerted by the speeding car on the parked car. Further, from Newton's first law, the speeding car would continue to move with the same velocity unless an unbalanced force acts upon it. Since there was a change in velocity of the speeding car, some force acted on the speeding car. Also, since the speeding car slowed down, that is, its acceleration was negative, the force acting on the speeding car was in the opposite direction of its motion. So what was this force acting on the speeding car? Recall from Newton's third law of motion that every action has an equal and opposite reaction. So when the speeding car hit the parked car, the parked car reacted by exerting a force on the speeding car. Now this force exerted by the parked car on the speeding car was equal in magnitude to the force exerted by the speeding car on the parked car. So what forces are acting here? Well, there is a force, let's call it Fs, which is the force exerted by the speeding car on the parked car, and there's another force Fp, which is the force exerted by the parked car on the speeding car. Also, Fs is acting in this direction, whereas Fp is acting in this direction. And the magnitude of Fp and Fs are the same. Here, we restrict ourselves to the forces exerted by these two cars. Everything else is external for us. So, for example, the force of friction is external to us and we don't incorporate that in this system. We are concerned only with the internal forces, which is the force exerted by the speeding car on the parked car and the force exerted by the parked car on the speeding car. Now let us quantify Fp and Fs. First, let us find the force exerted by the speeding car on the parked car. That is Fs. So how can we find Fs? Well, the force exerted by the speeding car on the parked car is the rate of change of momentum of the parked car. To calculate the rate of change of momentum of the parked car, let us assume that the mass of the parked car is equal to Mp. The velocity of the parked car before collision is Up. Even though it is zero in this case, we are using a general case scenario. Also, the velocity of the parked car after collision is Vp. Now, we know the mass of the parked car, we know its initial velocity, we know its final velocity. So, momentum is equal to mass into velocity, and hence we can find the initial momentum and the final momentum. So the initial momentum would be equal to Mp into Up, mass into initial velocity, and the final momentum would be mass into final velocity. Further, what we want to know is the rate of change in momentum. So we want to find the change in momentum first. So the change in momentum is final momentum minus initial momentum, and the rate of change in momentum is change in momentum divided by time, and this is Fs. So Fs is equal to MPVP minus MPUP divided by T. Similarly, we can find Fp, that is the force exerted by the parked car on the speeding car, which would be equal to the rate of change of momentum of the speeding car. Again, we assume that the mass of the speeding car is ms. The velocity of the speeding car before collision is us, and the velocity of the speeding car after collision is vs. So the initial momentum of the speeding car would be ms into us, and its final momentum would be ms into vs. Change in momentum would be final momentum minus initial momentum, and rate and change of momentum would be change in momentum divided by time. So Fp is equal to ms into vs minus ms into us divided by t. So we found both Fp and Fs, that is the force exerted by the speeding car on the parked car and the force exerted by the parked car on the speeding car. And from Newton's third law, we know that these two forces are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. So hence we know that Fs is equal to negative of Fp, because they are equal in magnitude and they are opposite in direction. So let us substitute the value of Fs and Fp that we've just derived in this. By substituting, we get MPVP minus MPUP divided by T is equal to negative of MSVS minus MSUS whole divided by T. We can cancel out the T from the denominator. We would be left with just the numerator. Now we could rearrange the numerator. So we get MPVP. Let us bring this on the LHS. So we get plus MSVS is equal to, let us bring this to the RHS. So we get MPUP plus MSUS. And what is this? Well, this is the final momentum of the parked car. This is the final momentum of the speeding car. So the LHS is the sum of the final momentums of both the cars. The RHS, this is the initial momentum of the parked car, and this is the initial momentum of the speeding car. So the RHS is the sum of momentums of both the cars before collision. And this equality sign tells us that the sum of momentum of both the cars before collision is equal to the sum of momentums after collision. So that is, the sum of momentums remain the same before and after collision. And this is known as the law of conservation of momentum, which states that when two or more bodies act upon one another, the sum of their momentums remain constant, provided no external forces are acting on the bodies. Recall, in our previous case, we restricted ourselves only to the forces Fs and Fp, that is the force exerted by the cars on each other. So when no external forces are acting on the bodies, the sum of their momentums remain constant.